Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our Tuesday with the Doctor. My name is Elder Annette Barnes, and we want to welcome those who are with us on Zoom, as those who may be watching on Facebook or YouTube, or even at a later date. Thanks for being with us. This evening, we have a special guest, Dr. Victor Czerkasij, who I hope I pronounced that correctly, to discuss America's number one cancer, treatable and preventable. We hope this will be helpful to you or for someone you know. Our speaker will give us a presentation and then take questions afterwards. You can ask questions either by unmuting yourself, putting your questions in the chat during or after the presentation. And if you are watching this live, you can put your questions in the Facebook Live chat comment section, and we will ask those. And if you would like to ask a question anonymously, please send them in the chat directly to me on Zoom. And so our speaker is a doctor of nursing practice in dermatology. He is a graduate twice of Southern Adventist University, Vanderbilt University, and Graceland University. He specializes in general dermatology, but in particular skin cancer and melanoma, psoriasis, atopic dermatitis, acne, and many other disorders and diseases of the skin. While Victor has spent nearly 25 years in healthcare, he is also an ordained pastor in the Adventist Church and enjoys preaching on most Sabbaths. Since the Russian invasion, Victor has been twice to the Ukraine, attending to the needs of wounded soldiers and civilians, and is returning for a third trip in April. And at this time, I would like to turn the time over to our presenter to tell us all about the number one cancer.
Thank you so much, Annette. I appreciate the invitation to be here all the way from Tennessee. For all of you that are in New York, actually, though you could be anywhere listening in, I was born and raised in New York City. And yeah, that's my background there. But I've lived all over the country and happy to be with you this evening. Listen very carefully. I was not able to create in time a PowerPoint that would be only for the layperson. I have here a PowerPoint that I've done in the last year for other healthcare professionals, those in dermatology and not. And what I'll do if you're patient is I'll move through some of the slides that don't apply to another provider and make it more interesting. Thanks to my shining personality and enthusiasm, after a long day, I saw 57 patients today, and here I am with you this evening. So let's get to work. And we're number one, skin cancer. That's unfortunate, isn't it? So let's go through these slides. And this is a really interesting case. I got a phone call from an emergency room here in the Chattanooga area. And they said, we have no idea what's going on. We're going to send you a photo. Can you take care of this gentleman? So we brought him over to our office. And I said, right off the bat, this is skin cancer. And they said, there's no way. And I said, yeah, this is actually most likely a basal cell. And this was a metastatic form of basal cell carcinoma. Now, all of our skin cancers are named based on where they come from inside the skin, right? So basal cell is in the base layer above the subcutaneous fat, slow growing. Then you have squamous cell, which is a shallow but fast growing skin cancer. I've already found two on my wife in our marriage of 43 years in May. And then, of course, melanoma, which is a very aggressive cancer from the melanocytes. So shockingly, this gentleman did survive because we were able to get the right medication for him. Here's some other nodular basal cells. And I have to wonder in my life, my whole career, I'm 62 years old, how in the world do you allow someone that you love get this far? So these are cancers that we do surgeries on. It was really good training for going to Ukraine, working on soldiers who had had, of course, injuries and wounds. So we were familiar how to do some plastic surgery there. And these are just classic basal cells. These people did survive. So non-melanoma skin cancer is our most common form of cancer in the U.S. It will be affecting this year, because these statistics are a little late because of COVID, but it'll be 6 million Americans annually. And a lot of folks not just have one skin cancer, they'll have 4, 7, 10. I did 5 biopsies on a man yesterday, a basal cell for sure, some squamous cell, and definitely a melanoma in there. So this is pretty aggressive stuff. A lot of people who are on chemotherapy, on radiation, they also will develop skin cancers because it's thought that while we save their life from, say, metastatic breast cancer, we can't also look at skin cancer as probably more controllable. If you're between, if you go up to the age of 65, you'll probably, about half of us listening, will have at least one basal cell or a squamous cell. And the numbers keep increasing. You like this truck driver? All these years driving a truck, where do you think most of our cancers are when I see patients? Yeah, that's right, on the left side, because that's where we get from driving. So in America, on the left side, Australia, the United States, it's on the right side. Now, let me ask you a question, everybody who's listening in. I had a man come in with his wife, about 20 years ago, and I found 5 basal cells on his right side. He was born and raised in America. What does he do for a living? He's a mailman. That's right. So he was shocked. He said, how did you know that? I said, well, 5 on one side. So for those who are, of course, in healthcare, we go through this pathology screen here and tell them where the squamous, basal cell, and melanocytes are. I'm going to move on here. Here's some of the risk factors again: male, fair skin, people who are tanning bed use. I have to tell you, tanning bed to skin is the same as cigarette smoking to lungs. I mean, it's absolutely going to be a no-brainer. Here in Cleveland, Tennessee, the city fathers got a lecture from me a few years ago. I found out talking to the young people in the high school that it appears that the girls, when they graduated from high school, they gave them one of 3 gifts. There was breast augmentation, a nice car, or a tanning bed. And I said, I won't make any comments on the first two, but the third one, you do not need to give that to your daughters. So people say, well, we need laws where, you don't go to a tanning bed at the mall. That's fine. You can buy one and have it at home. And that really ages you fast. So I mentioned my age. I hope I look young. That's because I practice what I preach. No facelifts, no surgery, no laser, anything like that. If you've had previous history of skin cancer, you're very likely to get more. Smoking, of course, severe skin problems, even like constant eczema, is very inflammatory on the skin. So is psoriasis. So these people tend to develop skin cancers as well. Kidney dialysis and being exposed to chemicals and radiation. I also think about people who are like welders. Radiation trigger, of course, is simply, let me make it very interesting and easy for everyone. What happens? Well, in the presence of ultraviolet radiation, the body, for example, will activate melanocytes in order to absorb ultraviolet, right? Well, all it takes is one cell that, while it's absorbing ultraviolet, there is action, and that action doesn't stop. That's called losing a tan. For some people, they lose a tan, but one cell keeps going. That, of course, is that replication of cancer, predominantly melanoma. I'm sorry, I've been seeing patients at 7 a.m. and a little tired. So solar keratosis or actinic keratosis, known as precancers, they move to something called squamous cell. We have a lot of treatments. Freezing is a very popular one. We have medications of different kinds, 5% fluorocell, imiquimod. And we put these on for precancers as a cream. And people really like this product, and we can write these prescriptions. Another thing we do is freezing, liquid nitrogen. It can be painful. And the person who doesn't know what they're doing, it can leave some white spots, but it does destroy them. Here's some people that receive some hypopigmentation or loss of skin and blisters that formed as a result of too much freezing. Here's some precancers right here. These little horns, they did not prove to be cancer, but they look pretty aggressive, don't they? So we do biopsy. I do shave biopsies predominantly. So I see something, I put a little purple line, I do the injection, and then I shave it and send it off to the lab, and then I cauterize it, and that's pretty quick. I can do that in about 40 seconds. So basal cell is the most common form of non-melanoma skin cancers, and it does result in about 6 I've heard as many as 10,000 deaths waiting on the new CDC numbers since COVID. This is a classic basal cell. It's a beauty, ulcerated at the center. It's got its own blood flow, rarely metastasizes. There's all kinds of different subtypes. There's nodular, morpheiform, superficial, sclerosing. We have pigmented, all kinds of basal cells. Fortunately, we got a lot of good treatment. High cure rate in the early stages. These basal cell, unfortunately, favor the face, tops of the hands, the scalp, and they come up pretty quick, and they're itching and painful. Everyone thinks they have a wart at first. Now, that, of course, is not a wart. That is a basal cell, and it was pretty much the entire top of the man's skull. We were able, again, save this person's life. We had some massive grafts that we had to do. It took all day, but we did a good job, and the person's doing well. This is called a sclerosing basal cell, and you can see it took the man's eye, and very unfortunate, but, you know, once again, we save people's lives. We have some ulceration here from a basal cell, telangiectasis. More all around the eye, the nose, they're very pearly. Here's a pigmented basal cell, and they, of course, look like a melanoma. I'll just biopsy it and send it to the lab, and of course, the person will undergo surgery, most likely. Superficial basal cells are just like scaly skin. People think that they have eczema, but it's a single solitary patch. This is very tricky. A morpheiform basal cell, you tap it with your fingernail and it kind of makes a thumping sound like you're buying a cantaloupe at the store. And it's just a different texture. I've sometimes told my students, I'll say, well, it's like two ghosts having a pillow fight in a raging snowstorm. You can't see it. It's really, really hard to see. So you have to be on your toes not to miss something like that. Again, it's very different shade and different texture. Infiltrative basal cell, of course, you know it's a skin cancer because you weren't born with it. It won't heal. And I always tell my patients, the moment you have one that comes up and won't heal, you just come on in that day. I'll get you on the schedule. Let's biopsy it and get you home and then wait for the result. We do have some things that mimic a basal cell. These are called pyogenic granulomas. You could get a splinter or a hard kiss or a fork in your lip, or someone can hit you on the head and you develop these little blebs. They're nothing but blood blisters, but I do biopsy them because I don't want to miss a nodular melanoma or a basal cell. So how do we treat these things? Well, generally, it depends on, like real estate, location, location, location. End of your nose, you probably don't want to lose that. So we have to do a very careful surgery called Mohs surgery, named after Dr. William Frederick Mohs. And he's passed away, but he developed a procedure which allows us to spare the healthy tissue and have a really good plastic surgery result, a good, we call it superior closure. And then, of course, make sure we get all the cancer. That's what you're interested in. That's what we're interested in, dermatology as well. Here's somebody that obviously does not have skin cancer, but she's demonstrating how to put these creams on. So we have some creams that are available, but their cure rate is a lot lower. Hey, there's me. We do where we are radiation therapy. And of course, folks who are probably 50 and older are terrified of the word radiation. But in the old days, we didn't have the technology to control the width, the strength, and the depth. So if I had skin cancer, I would choose surgery because, I'm sorry, if I had skin cancer, I would choose radiation because it's a very safe option, very effective, and it does require 15 treatments over like a 2-3 month period, but it takes 20 seconds each time, and it's a great way to go. So there it is, superficial radiation therapy, and very light redness, and really one of the oldest treatment strategies, but now nothing like it was a long time ago. I'll skip over this. Then we do have oral options for advanced basal cell carcinoma. Fantastic medications. Interesting line we tell people, you can take it till you can't take it anymore. These are pretty interesting medicines that you have to really know what you're doing. But I've had people in their 80s on these products, and doesn't require surgery or radiation. So we'll skip over that right now. Let's go to squamous cell. Squamous cell carcinoma is a fast-growing skin cancer. It's fairly destructive if it's let go on a quick basis, right? So we tell people they got to move in pretty quickly in order to get assessed, diagnosed, biopsied, and treated. It has a higher death rate than basal cell because it'll take you quickly if you're not paying attention. By the way, does anyone want for just a quick moment to wonder where in the world did tanning come from? You ever think about that? Where did the idea of a tan come from? For thousands of years. Back in the years of the Greeks, right? In ancient BC times, if you were Caucasian or wealthy, you hid your skin from the sun and you allowed slaves to work outside, force them, and you protected yourself. But where did it all of a sudden turn to tanning? Well, in the 1950s, there was a woman by the name of Coco Chanel, and what she did was she went to the French Riviera in the 1950s, and she pulled a blanket out, or, you know, a beach towel, and she put it on the sand, and she just sat there, and everybody was like, what are you doing? And she said, I'm wealthy. I have spare time. I have leisure. And I'm just going to sit here in the sun. And everybody's like, wow, that's really something that's never happened. And that's where we got the modern idea of tanning, was Coco Chanel. So thank you, Coco, because I can put food on my table thanks to all the skin cancers we have now. But that's where that began in the 1950s. Once again, people have undergone chemotherapy, or transplant patients who undergo medications that are immunosuppressive. They're the ones that are very vulnerable populations. I had a young lady today, and she's been undergoing chemotherapy for a rare kidney condition. And we talked about with her family that she could develop squamous cells. So that was kind of an important lecture to have with them. Squamous cell oftentimes looks like a wart, which it fools everyone at first, but warts are generally reserved for children. It's a virus, goes very quickly. Everybody knows Willy Wonka, right? Willy Wonka, there was a smart mouth little girl. Her name was Veruca Salt. Well, Veruca means wart. I remember sitting in class at Vanderbilt the first time I read about Veruca. Made me laugh. So Bowen's disease is a form of squamous cell. This is a classic presentation. Sometimes I get fooled. I biopsy. It comes back as basal cell. Who cares, right? I biopsied it. I thought it was a cancer. So we'll skip over that one. Invasive squamous cell carcinoma is another form, and it's slow and extremely destructive. Keratoacanthoma, these things come up in 2 weeks. I did a surgery once on a man's right-hand dorsum, and he came back 2 weeks later for suture removal, and he had on his left-hand dorsum, which is what we call the top of the hand, a skin cancer. I said, wow, these things come up fast. He said, well, you caused it. I said, well, how did I cause it? He said, because you did surgery on this hand, and when you cut into it, the cells traveled all through my body, and they went to the top of this hand. And I was like, stop. I said, look, he ran a lawn service. And I said, you got your hands out there all the time on your tractor. And I said, you burned your hands at some time, and they're coming up now. And interestingly, he did have more cancers in the consecutive months after that. Very destructive. So Dr. Frederick Mohs, University of Wisconsin, he passed away about 20 years ago. He developed this surgery, which allows us to get the cancer, check it under the microscope while you're there in the office. If we have clear margin, no cancer around that area, we'll close you up. But also, if you have cancer, it'll show us where it's going, and we'll just keep getting the cancer. We remove that tissue. We mount it on slides. People I work with, pathologist looks under there. He's very studious. And then together, we close that area once they're cleared. This is a simple O to 2 closure that we do in plastic surgery. The O is the defect where the cancer was. The T is the closure. I think I can tell a funny story here because, well, you know, what's the worst that can happen? You can never have me back on, right? So I did a surgery where I did an O to T, and the man said, hey, I'd like to see it before you put a bandage. I said, sure, let's show off my outstanding surgical skills. And suturing skills, and the man saw the tea and he started yelling. He was so angry, and he was going to get a lawyer and he was going to sue us. And I called the doctor that owned the practice, and he was threatening all kinds of hell and brimstone fire and lightning on us. And we just said, "What are you talking about?" He goes, "This is a standard surgical closure." And we're like, "Yes, it's in all the textbooks. You learn it the first year to close it in OTT. The reason you do it is because it doesn't allow the tension on the forehead to split, and it heals nicely." And he goes, "What letter is this?" And I said, "Well, it's a T." And he said, "Well, I'm a Georgia fan." I was like, "You got to be kidding me. I wasn't even thinking that, because we're in Tennessee and he's a Georgia fan. And he thought he'd have a T the rest of his life on his forehead." He asked me, "Where did you go to school?" I said, "Well, it wasn't Tennessee." And nobody else did either. So he felt a lot more calm after that. But it's just one of those funny things in healthcare. This is called an O to Z. And I don't know why we call it that, because it's an S. But anyway, O to Z rotation flap, it's a classic. So on the right, we had the defect, and on the left, we had the closure. This is a great story. My wife saw this man in Olive Garden, and she saw something on his neck. He had a unbuttoned shirt. And she said, "Are you going to go over and say something to that man?" I said, "No, he's having supper with his wife or whoever. I don't know. Why would I bother him?" She said, "You should go speak to him." And I said, I don't want to say anything. So I went over finally, and I said, "My wife told me I should come over and mention you have a skin cancer there." The wife said, "See, I told you." And I gave him my card. He came in the next day and, well, ended up in surgery. So we did a nice closure. I've been seeing him for over 10 years now. This is called helical advancement flap. And basically, looks like he ran into Mike Tyson, got a chomp on the ear, and then, you know, we fixed that up nicely. This was a massive basal cell, and it took all day, but we did a graft, and yeah, saved the lady. Did a really good job, and very difficult to see that she had a surgery today. This is a lady that smoked a lot, chewed tobacco. She lost the lower part of her chin. You can see the doctor I work with, his hands there putting it together. Look at that picture on the left. That's immediately post-op, and then 1 week later for suture removal. Look at that. Isn't that great? How happy these people are not to have cancer. They look good. They heal great. And, you know, I talked to a lot of nurse practitioners and PAs. My master's is a nurse practitioner. So I tell people, listen, you got to do what I put out here in your life as well. Avoid the tanning beds, avoid sunburns, live your life. I was in Miami and Hawaii, and I love the sun, but it's best not to get involved with burns. So I talked about the tanning beds. They contribute to skin cancers and melanomas, and they are a proven human carcinogen. So here's the tips I tell people. What's the best sunscreen? The one you use. And please do not engage me in a conversation that sunscreens cause cancer. That is the most incredible malarkey that you can possibly believe. That's flat earth right there. I don't have time for that. We would have outrageous amounts of cancers all traced back, but it's a fixed illusion. It's not true. There's no evidence to that. That sunscreen danger research is flawed. They always use hairless rats, and they expose them to ultraviolet. Basically, you would be receiving on the planet Venus. So it's, yeah, I'll tell you what, you know what else? Burnt toast. You can eat burnt toast every day, and that is a carcinogen. But the sunscreen part is just over the top. Don't do that to me. Don't smoke. Protect the eyes. I often tell people to get ultraviolet glasses that protect the UV rays. Seek the shade when you can in the middle of the day. Use those protective SPF clothes. And when you go see someone in dermatology, if they don't put you in a gown, go find someone else. You need to find people that look at you head to toe, right? Eyes, nose, ears, mouth, neck. They need to palpate you in all the different lymph glands. And that's the only way you're going to get a really good exam. So Consumer Reports told us back in 2019 that they recommend the following sunscreens. About SPF 30 or higher is what I use. And I only have a little rosacea. Probably the blood pressure is up from a long day. But these are the ones that have been recommended and do a very good job. and minimal absorption. For anyone worried about sunscreen still, you don't want absorption, zinc oxide or titanium dioxide. Those two products do not absorb. Once they go on, they stay on all day. So those are good suggestions. So thank you for your attention. And are there any questions that I might entertain? I had a half hour to present, and I'll take the time needed to answer questions.
That was awesome. Very interesting. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Annette.
I didn't realize, and how would I, that there were so many different types of skin cancer. I figured you just, got a little red and
nope.
The doctor froze it off and you're done.
I've had a lot of people come in lately. Unfortunately, when Jimmy Buffett passed away, he died of an extremely rare cancer called Merkel cell. Merkel cell carcinoma, unfortunately, when you see it, it's already too late. That's not a good thing. So we're very sad for that. I've seen Merkel cell twice in my career, so it is very, very rare. I see cancer every day. But yeah, that one was really unfortunate. Of course, a lot of people have died from melanoma that are famous. John McCain, former U.S. senator, he passed away of that. Of course, Bob Marley died of melanoma on the toe. And Burgess Meredith had melanoma. He's the guy that played the penguin, or in Rocky, he was the trainer. Come on, Rocky. So yeah, any questions from our audience today?
So we have a few. I mean, it's interesting. You mentioned you could actually die from skin cancer if it's not treated, and it seems like it's such a treatable thing.
That's the point. Everyone tells me. I have people come in, and this happens about once a year. Hey, can you tell me what this is? I go, yeah, it's a skin cancer. Okay, thank you. And they walk out. I'm like, where are you going? I'm not worried about it. It's just a cancer. I said, listen to me. You can die when it metastasizes. So please, let me biopsy it.
So how fast can it spread?
It depends. It depends on a person's immune system status overall. So I've seen some people, from the time we biopsy it to even almost surgery, like 2 months later, because we're so booked up, but we generally try to get people in within 2-3 months, it already starts moving along. And they may have, for example, kidney dialysis in the background, or maybe they're being treated for another form of cancer. So generally immune system status determines how fast it's going to go. But it is cancer, and we take it very seriously. If you took all the cancers in America, uterine, breast, brain, lung, ovarian, put them all together, you still don't have the total that we have in skin cancer. So we make up over just half of all the cancers in America.
Wow. Yeah, that's actually impressive. Did not
realize. Very good. In healthcare in America today, every day, about 35% of all the diagnoses that will occur in America, no matter where you are, what specialty, will be skin. But we only make up about 1% of the healthcare personnel. So we're always, always busy.
Wow. Now you mentioned something, and there's a question. Are you're more susceptible to skin cancer if you have other skin diseases or other issues in your body? Is that accurate?
Yeah. So let me throw out a few. We know that a lot of things like lupus, psoriasis, chronic eczema, a number of different scleroderma, these are inflammatory conditions. And anytime you have inflammation in the body, you have inflammaging. Did you like that, Annette? Inflammation is inflammation, inflammaging. You will not live as long or as healthy or as happy with constant inflammation in the body. So when you have inflammation, that really is one of the bases for the propensity of developing a cancer of any form. So yeah, that's a, I hope, a good succinct way to put it together.
Yeah, no, that's very interesting. It causes you to, you should be more aware, I guess. We need to be more aware. You mentioned a lot of different types of skin cancer, which I didn't, are there ones that are more dangerous? Because you like the basal cell, and then the melanoma, and then there's this.
Basal cell, squamous cell, melanoma, yeah. Those are the three basic ones. So sometimes we catch the trifecta in one visit. Everybody has one of each. So you're basically saying without saying it, what's the good cancer?
Yeah, like, what's the one that's, doesn't have to scare me so bad?
I found squamous cell twice on my wife, as I mentioned. She's fine. They come up pretty quick, but they're extremely shallow. So once you get treated, it leaves a small scar if you choose to do surgery. And then, of course, radiation is an option as well. So squamous cell, but I did show you statistics where it's killing more people than basal cell, which can be rather destructive. It's really hard to choose. It's basically your form of cup, your form of poison. By the way, hi to Holly Gad, one of the great influential people in my life, Dr. Holly Gad, and I just want to give her a shout out.
Yes, welcome. So I think you mentioned that the treatment for skin cancer, sometimes that can that cause more issues in the future or
Well,
concerns?
there is a belief, which is a complete urban myth, that
Okay.
by cutting into cancer, we spread that. That is an absolute falsity. The only time that's true is in aspiration for a breast cancer. They can do a breast biopsy, and they call it needle aspiration. There's a very, very small chance that you can spread those cells. Generally, in skin cancer, not true at all. Other complications, of course, are surgical. When you do surgeries, you could have scars. You could also have infection. When you do radiation, you can also break the skin on some people. I don't recommend radiation. It's very thin. Other problems are diabetes. So, or what about people who are on three blood thinners? So that's like, trying to do surgery on a water balloon. And I do find that it's not easy. It's really, really not easy to do certain surgeries because of background issues.
Okay, that's good to know. That I'm sure makes your job a little more challenging as you have to consider how the best way to treat something.
Yeah.
So what about, say, like sunspots or freckles?
It means you're alive. It's wonderful.
That's good.
People say, how can I stop getting these? I go, stop living. But yeah, so let me tell you what sunspots are. Basically, when you were 19 years old and you went to Pensacola or Panama City or, New Smyrna Beach or wherever in Florida for your spring break, you came back, and for the Caucasians, you were very happy that you had this even tan, right? Maybe if you're Irish, it wasn't a good thing. But because, they never tan, they burn when you have the red hair. However, when you got that tan that was nice and even, after a few decades, your body is now very annoyed with you. Your skin is unhappy. And it says, you know what? I don't trust you anymore. I'm going to go ahead and activate permanently on your hands, on your face, all different kinds of places, these brown spots. They will absorb ultraviolet. Unfortunately, I'm not going to do it evenly because I'm mad at you. I owe you. So that's what those brown spots are. And women will develop melasma on their face and forehead, which also can be contributed by hormonal action as well as sunshine. And these patches, while they are irregular, they do serve a purpose, which is absorbing ultraviolet. It's just not even anymore.
Interesting.
So
So,
the way not to get them is when you're younger, don't keep tanning.
right. So we have
But
to
what do you do
target.
when what do
Go
you do
ahead.
when they're really when you're old and you think that they're ugly?
Oh.
Okay, so we do have some awesome medications for that. A lot of them are compounding pharmacies. I've developed a few in conjunction with these companies. These products, I include hydroquinone, tretinoin, kojic acid, even a little hydrocortisone. And these things are extremely effective, these compounds, and you apply them every evening for up to 3 weeks to 4 weeks. Shockingly, they work. So I do have women, though, that women. Sorry, it just happens to be mostly women that care. And they keep applying it, and you can develop an ivory patch, kind of off-white patch. So you've got to make sure you got that balance and you don't tilt off the other way. So you can't use like household bleach or anything.
There's a devil's advocate right there. Yeah, we don't have any home remedies for that. So I would recommend those things that are tried and tested. About vitamin C, like vitamin C serum?
So I use vitamin C serum every single morning. I use 10% over the counter. And then in the evening, I use hyaluronic B5. These are two over-the-counter products you can literally buy in Target, Publix, Walgreens, Walmart, CVS. And they're about $20 each, and they last forever. So that's all I do. And you can see I got a pretty
Very
firm
glowing.
face. I'm glowing.
Yes, very glowing skin. It's good. Good skin.
But yeah, I mean, that's what I do. And plus, of course, I try not to burn.
Okay. So that's pretty awesome. So there's a couple questions related to that. I mean, if can you possibly, like, somebody look at their face or their hands or skin and start noticing something might be happening and maybe catch it early
Yeah.
before it turns into skin cancer and prevent it? And how would you do that? How would
Yeah,
somebody do that?
so regular visits to see someone like myself. My last patient today was so happy. He said, "It's been 5 years since I had a cancer." I said, "The reason, I'm sorry. Yes, it's been 5 years since he had a cancer and he hasn't had to have surgery." And I said, "And why is that?" "Because you come on a regular basis and I'm thorough. The two of those things together, he doesn't have to come. He comes in every 6 months. I freeze a few spots. I can write him a cream to apply to these areas. I can also do an injection and burn them off. So all these are preventative, and he's very happy. So I remind him, and we ended up talking more about our families than we did his skin, because frankly, at this point, it's just maintenance. It's just like taking care of a car.
Okay, yeah,
Why
that's
wait till the transmission goes? You got all these red lights on your dashboard. Fix it. Prevent it.
I got to take notes here. Yeah, no, that's great. And that actually that goes to a couple questions that we have coming in. So what are tips for finding a good dermatologist? And should you only visit the dermatologist when you have concerns, or should you regularly visit a dermatologist?
So the American Academy of Dermatology, which is 11,000 dermatologists nationwide, is meeting next week in San Diego. I happen to be a guest speaker there. I'm not a medical doctor. I'm a doctor of nursing practice, but I'm speaking there next Thursday in San Diego. And when they gather together, the AAD, they have made the recommendation that all Americans 40 and older need to go to see a dermatologist for the first time for assessment, and then from there, take their advice to how often you need to come. You absolutely need to go on an annual basis if you have a blood relative with skin cancer. The simple fact is, all the statistics show that you have a 50% increase over the rest of the population when you have a direct family line. So neither my mother or father have skin cancer. But I still look at strange moles and things like that. Another thing is, depending what you do for work, if you're outside a lot, yeah, you need to come in. And of course, here's another interesting statistic. Our target audience for melanoma are girls between 16 and 29. 16 and 29. I had done surgery on a 2.5-year-old who got melanoma between their toe. She's now about 20 years old, but if she had lived in a cave, she could have still developed a melanoma. It just wasn't sun. So they came in, they didn't think it was a big deal. We biopsied it. Yeah, it was melanoma. So yeah, but 40 and older is the official stance, but there are qualifications to that.
Unless you're a woman, and then you should come in earlier than that.
I see a lot of teenagers for acne, and I ask the mother if I can see the young lady's back. Sometimes they get a little offended, or they want to know more information. So I say ahead of time, I go, "Listen, that's our target. I know you're here for acne. Can I just take a peek at the back just to make sure?" So 90% of the time there's nothing, but once in a while, whoa, hey, what about this?
Yeah, it was very strange. I ended up going to a dermatologist because I had a rash on my face that wouldn't go away. And then they were like, "Oh yeah, you should come in every year." And I was like, "For what?" So,
Well, you look like a rosacea patient to me, so.
no, I'm just glowing today. I just have
Okay.
it. They were like, "No, this is like a regular thing." I was like, "What are you talking about?"
We're all about prevention. I do not want any drama in my life. I want happy people, happy patients. I want to make sure that we don't deal with things like Jimmy Buffett. Interestingly, I have a friend, a very, very dear friend of mine, who lived in Key West for many, many years. And guess who he was friends with before he was famous? Jimmy Buffett. So when Jimmy passed away, I talked to this fella who's like, "We always told him to wear sunscreen, but he just loved the sun. He wasn't going to put it on. He felt it dribbling in his eyes. There's things he could have done. And I'm not saying that because Jimmy Buffett didn't want to wear sunscreen is why he got it. But we do know the sun is a vicious entity in space that really lays down the ultraviolet. We got to be careful. I love the sun. It's good for my seasonal affective disorder. You need it for vitamin D promotion. Just don't burn. Just don't burn.
Yeah, so that's a thing, because when some of us were kids, you know, it didn't matter. You just burned and suffered, right? Is that going to affect us later in life, the fact that when we were little kids running around in the ocean and stuff, our parents weren't quite as diligent as maybe some are today?
Yeah, increased burns are one of the big predictors of developing melanoma in the future. But also keeping yourself healthy. I practice the Mediterranean diet as best I can. It's one of our best sustainable anti-inflammatory, anti-aging diets that you can do in the world today. I mean, it's been around 5,000 years. Yeah. Eating really fresh fruits and vegetables. In fact, one of the best antioxidant things you can eat are blueberries. And we really promote blueberries when it comes to the skin. So I have about, I don't know, I would say I have about 3 or 4 cupfuls every week of blueberries. I make sure to buy them and eat them.
Awesome.
Really good for the skin, huh?
Hey, Victor, I have Hello. A question for you. The question is, you said that there are certain risk groups. Certainly those redhead, blue-eyed kids like I produced, you know, should be screened early. What about people who are have a lot of moles, when not just freckles, but have a lot of moles when they're young? I came in a few minutes late. Did you talk about mole things?
No, but we do, and thank you for bringing that up. As you can imagine, this is such an enormous topic. By the way, the skin, we argue with the people in the vascular area, but we're supposed to be the largest body organ, and we have the most diseases and disorders of any specialty. We have over 3,200 diseases and disorders, and you just got to know a lot. And there's so many people that come into dermatology and run as if their hair's on fire because they say, this is just too hard. I'm going back to cardiac or kidney. And I'm like, really? But there's a way to teach and a way to learn it. But people who have what's called FAMS, F-A-M-S, and it's a familiar, acquired, melanocytic, I can't remember the whole term, mole syndrome. These people with multiple moles are very, very likely to have more increase of abnormal moles, especially based on burns and immune system status. So it takes a very careful look, and it's hard to tell. You know, people always say, well, what am I supposed to be looking for? And I go, you know what? It's taking me, you know, 2.5 decades. So why don't you just come let me worry about it? I don't think I could teach you today. Yeah. But you just know it when you see it. And that's a really hard thing to teach.
Interesting. So another good reason to visit the dermatologist, just to make sure.
And that said, today I did a biopsy on a lady, first time she came in, because it's interesting. Couples are funny. They'll either come together or they'll send the spouse. And then the spouse is like the first one to see me. And they come back like, you know, he's normal. He has a sense of humor. He was thorough. Why don't you come in too? So she came in and said, my husband had a good experience. I thought I'd come in also. And I found, I'm sure it's a melanoma in her left armpit. And she wasn't going to tell me. She was going to see if I found it. And she said, that's the reason I'm here. So people do that a lot. They hide this Easter egg on me. And I'm like, oh, that's got to go. They're like, oh, I was wondering if you find that. So it's single, solitary, irregular, wasn't born with it, turning very black and itchy.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So sunscreen, should we wear it every day regardless?
Only because it's a good habit. And what I recommend are moisturizers that have at least 15 to 30 SPF. So okay. Here's the interesting thing about moisturization. If you're not at 40 and older, we're not producing it enough, right? So when you're a teenager, you're oily. Oil or sebum is thanks to your testosterone or your estrogen pushing that oil. Well, what bacteria is the breeding ground, loves to breed in the oil? Well, that's acne. Mm. Now, do people 40 and older develop acne? No, because we're dry. And so if you moisturize, what you're essentially telling your body or your skin, hey, I got this. You don't have to make oil. I will go ahead and add moisturization. The skin calms down and it does do a firming plumping. So anything, we have so many good creams. I don't work for these companies, but CeraVe, Cetaphil, Aveeno, Gold Bond, Eucerin. I use Eucerin a lot because they have a lot of research behind it. And so, yeah, I do that. And I use Dove soap, unscented in the shower, any moisturizing soap. And of course, I take a hot shower if I want one very quickly. If you stand there and think about your day, it just takes off your essential oils.
Interesting. Okay. I know my dermatologist was trying to get me to wear sunscreen on my face, and I don't like the smell of sunscreen.
Oh, let me tell you about the Vanicream line. Vanicream, it's spelled V-A-N-I, Vanicream, V-A-N-I. And they have a whole line of conditioner, shampoo, lotions, shaving cream, antiperspirants. They're all paba-free, dye-free, lanolin-free, fragrance-free. It's just not free. That's very, very good stuff. No scent to it. And my parents are very picky. Dad just turned 95 last week, and he loves Vanicream.
Good to know. Good to know. All right. So so even if it's not sunny outside, we should just be in the habit of putting it on our face and our hands and our arms just every day, like get up in the morning, put it on.
I once got burned on a cloudy day. Ultraviolet, there's three forms. It'll come through.
Okay. All right. So there's a common thought. It's another question just came in, that darker skinned individuals do not need sunscreen. What are some concerns or reason to wear sunscreen for darker individuals?
So darker skinned people can burn. Darker skinned people also can get dark patches like melasma. In fact, I would say my largest clientele for melasma are female Black patients, also Hispanic and Asian. And they get very, very dark patches, which are usually stimulated by increased exposure to the sun. The other thing is, if you believe in the free radical form of aging of the body, ultraviolet will do it. So you can really look younger longer. Now, darker skinned people have a higher collagen count. That's a scientific thing. It's not in any way racist, but we're different. White people, we have less collagen. You never hear of a darker skinned person getting collagen injection in their lips or their skin because they have naturally what we want ourselves as Caucasians. But they can degrade that collagen very rapidly in the presence of constant ultraviolet. And one of the really tricky things for darker skinned people is they can form very aggressive melanomas, generally on palms of hands, soles of feet, and under the fingernails. So like I told you, Bob Marley from Jamaica, he developed melanoma and it had metastasized and killed him. So.
Wow. So everybody should use sunscreen.
Yeah. Also the Black population suffers at a much, much higher rate of discoid lupus erythematosus than everybody else. And lupus is also linked to cancer development. So yeah, we need to see those folks on a regular basis, all of us, for different reasons.
Is it just the sun that can cause skin cancer?
I had a gentleman that come in some years ago, and I noticed he had only squamous cell above his eyebrows and also his upper arms. And I sat there and I blinked a few times and I said, I know what you do for a living. He said, what? Can you guess? I said, yeah, you're a welder. He goes, yeah, I am a welder. How'd you know that? I said, because your mask covers your eyes, but the ultraviolet from the welding hits your forehead and probably your glove only goes up to your elbow. And he had developed squamous cells there. He's like, wow, it's amazing. I said, well, different job occupations can impact your skin.
Interesting. Wow. Okay. So one of the things you mentioned, several things to help avoid getting skin cancer and to kind of block the light out. Tinting windows on our cars, we're not allowed to do that in New York.
Really?
Yeah, it's illegal. I know, we don't live in the South. I guess we have less sun than all you Southerners, right?
Well, you know, in New York, you should be able to do it. And then you get a doctor's letter when you get pulled over. You just give them your letter.
There we go.
You'd be pulled over every day, though.
So what are some other things that maybe we can do? And are we less susceptible to skin cancer because we're in a northern part of the country?
You know, but I was in Ukraine before the war, and my friend took us to this resort, which it was doing so well before the war. I can't begin to tell you how beautiful and how wonderful, cultural, happy we were in Ukraine visiting many, many times before the war. And I was so happy where the country was going. There was this palpable feeling that, oh man, we're going places here.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I went to this resort and I got there and I realized, oh no, I don't have any sunscreen. I didn't think I was going to be at this pool place. So I was stressing all day long at this place. I was covering myself with towel and everybody's looking at me like, what is wrong with you? I never got any color. I never got the slightest, you know, redness or anything. And I read this article. I was trying to figure it out. We were at a latitude even with Montreal. And the point was the rays are angled differently and we were just protected. So it's very, very rare at higher latitudes to get those kind of burns. And where I am is the seventh circle of hell when it comes to skin cancer and melanoma. Where you guys are, not as much. So that's a blessing.
That this is really helpful. This explains a lot because I feel like I used to live in Tennessee and I feel like I burned a lot more before I became an adult. And I was maybe I just grew out of it, but I moved.
Yeah, if you think about the earth in the summer, especially in the northern latitude, we get it really, really quick, but the ultraviolet has to travel a little longer to hit the angle where you are in New York. So by then it dissipates, so you don't get the full force. And by the time it was in Ukraine, it was a sunny day. Well, I got nothing that day. I still remember that with shock to this day. I was like waiting to turn into a fried lobster, but nothing.
Well, and this is why I wonder, do I really need sunscreen? Because when I'm in the sun for a period of time, I don't typically sunburn. Sometimes I'll get a little light red, but and it'll be gone the next day or something. But I don't you know, burn like I did in the South. And well, I'm like, no, I'm
a rebel at these conferences. And I have people come up to me and they're like, you know, I agree with you, but I can't say it out loud. And I tell people, when you get to the beach, that's when you should put on the sunscreen. They're like, oh, put it on before you get to the sun, the beach. I go, no, you need 20 minutes of uncovered exposed skin to the sun to get vitamin D production. We need that.
Yeah.
And we just don't get, we're so down in vitamin D in this country. It's unbelievable.
Yes. No, it's a good point. There has to be some sort of balance where you can get your vitamin D, but you don't burn yourself and you don't get skin cancer.
It's a very organic way of getting vitamin D. I asked my doctor last month when I went for my annual, I said, can you do my vitamin D when you do the blood work? He goes, I'm sure you're fine. I said, just check. It was nearly non-existent. It was so low. My number was like 19. It's supposed to be, you know, 60, 80. And I was like, I told you.
Yeah.
And I take supplements and it still wasn't enough.
Yeah. My doctor just tests for it automatically. I mean,
yeah.
She just tests for it every year automatically. Like, I'm like, okay.
I wish insurance companies paid for me to go to Hawaii in the middle of winter. It's for my health, you know?
Just for my health. Exactly.
It's for my health.
Exactly. All right. We're starting to run out of questions. What is, what's the difference between rosacea and like being burned, sunburned?
Okay, so sunburn is sunburn. I mean, it happens very, very quickly and your skin peels and you're in pain and a lot of blistering. So that is basically a contact, right, with the sun.
Okay.
Rosacea is an inflammatory disease. A good question maybe would be, what's the difference between rosacea and acne? Acne is a bacterial infection by the bacteria acne. But rosacea is an inflammatory disorder that affects primarily men and women who are Scotch, Irish, Dutch, German, 40 and older. Women are more likely to develop rosacea, 8 to 1 over men. However, men, when they get it, can be pretty severe, like Carl Malden, the actor, or Tip O'Neill, or maybe somebody remembers W.C. Fields, My Little Chickadee. They had these big, large noses. That's called rhinophyma. We don't call it that anymore. It's called phimatis. But that swollen nose, that snoring, was always attributed to alcohol. Bill Clinton, for example, has rosacea, and you can tell by his nose a little bit red. Well, this inflammation is very genetic based, And it's made worse by coffee, chocolate, and caffeine, hot foods, spicy foods, and foods that are acidic like tomatoes, strawberries, and pineapple, and red wine. I would say the two biggest triggers are sunshine and stress also.
I was just going to ask if it was related to, if sunshine makes it worse, because you can sometimes see that. So that's what I was wondering.
So one of the worst things you could do is a Mexican restaurant, and you could have, your margarita, a sour cream with the spicy beans and tomato salsa, and then you go outside in the sun. That is Rosaciaville right there. I guess Jimmy would have sung Margaritaville, but that's Rosaciaville. So folks like yourself that suffer from that really need to prevent by A, finding out what your trigger is, and B, using sunscreen.
Okay, so is there a natural way to avoid it, or just...
Yeah, well, knowing what your trigger is. I have one woman, and she and I have been friends for 20 years, and she has rosacea. And the only thing that breaks her out is a glass of red wine at the end of the day. She said, I'm not going to give up on that. And I said, then we're fine. I said, that's your choice. Don't complain to me about your red face, though. but a natural way would not be drinking that red wine. That is her trigger. So identifying your trigger is very helpful for rosacea.
Awesome. All right. So our last question is, can you go through what your skin care routine is for yourself? Again, you said you used vitamin C. We got to write this down. What is your skin care routine?
I use every morning vitamin C serum. I've been doing this for 25, 30 years. Vitamin C serum, 10%. Higher percentages are available, but they're highly expensive. I'm kind of cheap. So 10% vitamin C serum. And I think one of the better brands are CeraVe, CERAVE, and La Roche-Posay. I don't work for these companies. I make no kickback, nothing like that. I just think they're superior products, La Roche-Posay. Then in the evening, I use Hyaluronic B5. And once again, the same companies, I think, do a good job. Hyaluronic B5 is a form of B vitamin that really plumps up the skin. I will throw in one more thing. You can use a wash in the shower. For heaven's sake, it just slipped my mind. I'm telling you, I've been going for 14 hours today.
Fine, you're doing great.
thank you. But I use a wash in the shower, like a Joseph soap, a sulfa soap, sulfacetamide soap. And I think that a couple times a week, Cleopatra used sulfacetamide or sulfa wash 2,000 years ago. And that really just takes off any excess oil and bacteria. It's kind of a, how do I say it? Kind of a defoliant. So you can buy that on Amazon.
And you mentioned for a bar soap like Dove unscented.
I do that. And a lot of men hate me for that. They're like, my wife now demands only. It feels slippery. I should feel squeaky. No. Squeaky.
Sounds squeaky.
Yeah. You're not supposed to be squeaky when you come out of the shower. You're supposed to be slippery. That's the lotion from the soap. And they got to change their mind around. So you should not. Dial, Irish Spring, not good soaps. Ivory is not a good soap. The marketing was awesome in the 60s and 70s, but it's not a good soap for your skin.
So not squeaky clean, slippery clean.
Slippery. That means you got lotion.
So I feel pretty good because I literally just bought this Dove unscented soap. So because I read it and it had no perfumes in it or anything. And my dermatologist was like, no perfumes in any. I was like, oh, okay.
I tell people all the time, you should value yourself. Don't shortchange yourself. Like get the best mattress, buy the best food, mm-hmm. get the best shoes, and take care of your skin.
Absolutely.
So, it's the only organ on display for the whole world. So.
Yeah. And it's interesting, the products that you're mentioning, CeraVe, La Roche-Posay, those were products that he also mentioned as being like, so you all are buying into the same company. No, I don't think you all are saying the same thing.
We're reading the same research.
You're reading the same research. No, this was awesome. Very informative. Really appreciate your time. I don't see any other questions. I don't hear anything from the audience. Just so happy to have you with us and to tell us about all of these things and just how we can live a fuller life right? Skin cancer free.
Thank you.
So I just want to thank everyone for coming and hope that it was helpful for you and that you learned something this evening, and those who may be watching later, this was helpful to you. And we'd just like to let you know our next Tuesday with the doctor is with Dr. Beth Burkhart, and to discuss the topic of the throat. She's an ENT, so she's talked to us about ears and the nose, and now she's going to talk about the throat. And that's on March 26th at 6:30 p.m. Other information can be found at our website at joyoftroy.org. Have a wonderful evening, everyone.
Thank you. Pray for Ukraine.
Yes. Yes.